Hello! Did you know that stroke is the fifth leading cause of death in the US alone? In fact, a second Hollywood celebrity recently succumbed to a stroke attack in the last couple of days. That's the second Hollywood death in just 3 months as a result of a stroke. Of those who survive, the vast majority usually end up with severe disability. There are over 790,000 stroke events in the US alone every year. So with such grim statistics in mind, it's a good idea to know what actually puts you at risk of having a stroke. That's what this video is about. We're going to be talking about the risk factors for stroke. That's what's coming up next, so stay tuned. I'll see you shortly.
Now for today's 2020 idea to better health, please welcome on stage Dr. Joe.
Hello, welcome back. I'm Dr. Joe of the drjoe.com. Well, if this is your first time on this channel, can I extend a warm welcome to you? This is your home of 2020 ideas to better health. So if you haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe. So I was having a chat with a nurse who works in the stroke unit attached to my hospital the other day, and she was telling me about how the incidence of stroke has actually gone up over the years. She's been working there now for about 17 years. And she said they're having more and more patients being admitted with strokes. But more worrying for her was the fact that the average age of the patients being admitted is getting lower and lower, which means younger people are actually having strokes. And for her, this was quite a concern. And her conclusion seems to be that people are not aware of the risk factors, that predispose them to having a stroke. And I think she's correct to a large extent. And that's what's compelled me to actually do this video, along with what's been going on in Hollywood in the last couple of months. Because if you are aware of your risk factors and you do something about them, you reduce your chances of actually having a stroke. So the point here is that stroke is preventable, but it's only preventable if you know your risk factors and you do something about them. So let's talk about the risk factors that actually predispose you to actually having a stroke. Let's get on with it.
So let's talk about the factors which, when put together, will contribute to your risk of actually having a stroke. Because knowledge of these factors will help you reduce your chances of actually developing a stroke. Now, we call them risk factors, as you know. In this instance, we're going to lump them into three broad categories. We have the medical conditions, we have lifestyle factors, and then the third group is going to be genetics, which to some extent you don't have too much control over. So we'll start with the medical conditions. Well, high blood pressure is one of them. If you are a subscriber to this channel, you know that I'm always talking about high blood pressure. Essentially, it's an arterial disease where the pressure within the vessel is usually higher than what you consider as normal every time the heart pumps or even when it's relaxed. Of course, is the most common cause of strokes because over half of strokes are actually due to problems with high blood pressure. High cholesterol is another risk factor. We need some cholesterol in our lives, but we don't need too much of it. Excess cholesterol, especially the bad cholesterol, is bad for our health and indeed can lead to strokes as well. Previous stroke attack is another. In this instance, I'm referring to transient ischemic attack. This is a situation where the stroke attack is temporary because whatever was blocking the vessel becomes dislodged and the vessel reopens up and blood flow is resumed, oxygen supply is resumed, and the symptoms resolve within a couple of minutes. But if you have a transient ischemic attack, or what we call mini stroke, you should consider it as a forewarning to a bigger stroke that may happen in future. So that is a very serious risk factor to take into consideration. Other medical conditions worth talking about will include things like heart disease. Now, atrial fibrillation is one heart disease that we have to talk about here. In atrial fibrillation, the upper chambers of the heart, what we call the atrium, is actually misfiring. Now, if this is left untreated, this will lead to formation of small, tiny clots. And because the heart is supposed to pump blood all around the body, some of these small, tiny clots get pumped to the blood vessels that are supplying the brain. Now, if enough tiny small clots are pumped to a vessel that is supplying any part of the brain and there's a complete obstruction, that ultimately will result in a stroke. Coronary heart disease is another. Your coronary vessels are the vessels that are actually supplying your heart muscle because your heart muscle needs oxygen for it to do its job properly. Now, if you got plaques in these blood vessels, potentially there could be a complete obstruction. When there's a complete obstruction, that leads to a heart attack. Now, even if you don't have a complete obstruction and you don't have a heart attack, the fact that you got plaques in these coronary vessels means you probably have plaques elsewhere in the other blood vessels in other parts of your body. Now, in this instance, we're referring to the brain. So if you got plaques in the blood vessels in your brain, that potentially can also lead to a stroke. Diabetes is another condition. Of course, we're all familiar with diabetes. In diabetes, we have problems with sugar control. Some people control their blood sugar very well, others don't. Now, if you belong to that category where you cannot control your blood sugars very well, over time, this is going to lead to high blood lipids. A combination of high blood sugar, high blood lipids will ultimately lead to formation of plaques. And if you got plaques, this is going to harden your blood vessels. And if your blood vessels are hardened, then of course you're going to develop high blood pressure. And if you got high blood pressure, that increases your chance of having a stroke. Sickle cell disease is another condition that can lead to strokes. This is a disease that tends to affect black people. In sickle cell disease, the red blood cells, instead of being rounded shaped, they are sickle shaped. And when the cells are sickle shaped, they have a potential to getting stuck to one another. Now, if enough sickle shaped red blood cells are stuck to one another, they potentially can obstruct a blood vessel. And if that happens to any blood vessel that is supplying any part of the brain, that by definition will lead to a stroke. Now, let's talk about lifestyle risk factors. And these are the things that you have very good control over. Well, smoking is one of them. If you smoke, your carbon monoxide levels are going to be high because the oxygen carrying capacity of your red blood cells is reduced. And of course, the smoking habit itself will lead to plaque formation. And if you got plaque in your blood vessels, they will harden. And if they are hardened, then of course, the pressure within them is going to be high. And that is, by definition, high blood pressure. Now, excessive alcohol intake is another lifestyle risk factor that we have to talk about. If you drink a lot, over time, you're going to have problems with your blood lipids, in particular your triglycerides. If they're high, then of course, you'll be courting high blood pressure as well. Other lifestyle factors will include obesity. In obesity, you have a high body fat percentage. And if you got a high body fat percentage, you're also going to have problems with high blood lipids, in particular triglycerides and a very low density lipoprotein cholesterol. This is a very bad cholesterol. If you've got that, then of course you're going to have high blood pressure because it's going to harden your blood vessels. And of course, if you're obese, then you are at risk of developing type 2 diabetes as well. And we've just talked about type 2 diabetes earlier on. Sedentary lifestyle is another thing that increases your risk of developing a stroke. If you're a couch potato, then you increase your chances of developing type 2 diabetes and high blood pressure and high blood lipids. And all of these combinations can actually lead to you developing a stroke. Another lifestyle factor we have to talk about is your diet. If your diet is high in saturated fat, we need some saturated fat in our diet, but if you have excess of it and you also have trans fat and you have a diet that is high in salt as well, you increase your risk of developing the bad cholesterol, and ultimately you're going to develop high blood pressure. And of course, high blood pressure is also a risk factor for strokes. Now, let's talk about genetics. This is the other category we have to talk about, but we don't have too much control over this. But the point here is that if you identify yourself in these three factors that I'm going to talk about here, and you have other risk factors that I talked about earlier, then you have to be more aggressive in taking care of those other risk factors because you don't have much control over these ones. So let's talk about then genetics. Age. We'll have to get older. We don't have a choice. You know, strokes tend to happen in the older age group. It is thought that your risk of developing a stroke doubles every 10 years if you're over the age of 55. So if you're over the age of 55, then you need to work harder if you've got the other risk factors that I talked about to reduce your risk of developing a stroke. Your gender is important. You have no control over that. Strokes tend to happen more in women than men. Why is this? Well, we seem to think that things like pregnancy, the use of birth control pills, in particular the combined oral contraceptive pill, and the hormones that are used in hormone replacement therapy, HRT, when women become menopausal, they can increase a woman's chance of developing a stroke. It's not a given, but they just increase a woman's chances of developing a stroke. Race is another. If you are Black, if you are Hispanic, if you are Native American Indian, you have a higher risk of having a stroke compared to a Caucasian or an Asian. So if you are Black, if you are Hispanic, if you are Native American Indian, and you've got any of those other risk factors, then you need to work harder to reduce your risk of actually developing a stroke.
So there you are. Those are the risk factors that predispose you to developing a stroke. Now that you're aware of them, if you do something about them, you reduce your chances of developing a stroke. Well, you are in luck, because on this channel, a lot of the things I talk about here are geared in that direction. So long as you implement them, you should be fine. So stroke is preventable. Now, I want to talk about the fact that stroke is actually treatable as well. And I'm going to illustrate it with a story of a lady whose husband had a massive stroke on the left side a couple of years ago. And she was determined that the husband was going to make a full recovery, and she succeeded. The husband underwent two surgical procedures. The first one was to evacuate the massive clot from the brain. The second one was to reconstruct his skull. And after that, they set about an exercise of full recovery, if you like. So I want to say big up to the people who work in the Raphael Hospital in England. They did a fantastic job, because they set this man on a path to full recovery. It was an intensive physiotherapy, intensive neuro rehabilitation, and they succeeded. And it was targeted. And indeed, that's the trick. It's got to be targeted. They targeted his upper limb. They targeted his lower limb separately. They targeted his speech, they targeted his memory, and they all succeeded. Working on each component every time, one step at a time, they succeeded in making this man achieve a full recovery. This man was back on his feet. He was doing his gardening. He was mowing the lawn, pushing the lawnmower himself. He was walking unassisted. And he was playing golf. He was doing everything that he did before he had a stroke. In fact, if you saw him, you will never know he actually had a stroke. It's got to be said that the wife was the driving force behind this, because she was determined that she was going to have her husband back, and she succeeded. When I was in medical school, they taught us that there was no regeneration at the level of the central nervous system, which means the brain and the spine. Of course, so if you had an injury there, that was it. You were damaged for life, and that was it. But medicine has moved on since then, because as was proven by this lady who was the driving force behind the husband's recovery, if you've got a muscle, if you use it, it will work. It's as simple as that. So you've got to work it for it to spring back into action, and it just requires a bit of persistence and a bit of targeted practice, and it will be back to normal. So here's the thing. I want you to send this video to your family members, because in the event that you end up with a stroke, hopefully not, because we're stressing prevention, but in the event that you end up with a stroke, send this video to them and let them know that they should not give up on you, because full recovery is possible. It just requires patience. In this man's case, it took about 3 years, but they still succeeded. So they must not give up on you. All right, so please share this video with them, because it may help you in the long run. Okay, so as usual, if you like this video, give it a thumbs up. By the way, there's the stroke book, the dummy series. You're aware of the dummy series. I'm going to leave a link in the video description. If you fancy getting your hands on that book, it explains more about strokes. And if you want to get it, the links are going to be right there in the video description. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do subscribe. If you got any comments to make, please leave your comments right down below. Okay, I think that's about it. Message here is this: stroke is preventable, and stroke is also treatable. Okay, that's the message I want you to take home today. That's about it. Until next time, where this is Dr. Joe signing out.